ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 323. I am your host, Reed Murphy. Happy New Year, everybody. It is 2024. Somehow we made it. Somehow. We're kicking it off to a... We got an unhinged start here behind the scenes as we launch the show. Joined here by the lovely host of the 323's College Shame Day. As always, Scott Ellia is here generating just making horrible use of AI.
I'm pretty sure the FBI is going to be knocking down my door after they see that algorithm popping up.
Yeah, I mean, we really launched into Nepo Baby New Year, right? As we're talking about Anderson Cooper. And you know what? Happy New Year to you. I don't know how you, how do you celebrate the New Year? Did you stay up? Did you actually make it to midnight?
Listen, just because I'm white doesn't mean I celebrate it in any different way than anybody else. We're all the same. But me, I'm an old man, and I was in bed by 10 o'clock. And I woke up at 2 to get a drink of water. I saw it was 2. I said Happy New Year to myself and went back to sleep.
Okay. Look at that. I mean, you can't hate on that. Look, I think you get to a certain age and like you start to realize it doesn't really matter. And I mean, shit, you're going to wake up no matter what. It's going to be 2024. It's not like you have to see the New Year's ball drop, or if you're in Idaho, the potato. They have a potato drop out there.
Really?
Like in the Capitol. Yeah, they have like a big ass potato that drops and there's like fireworks shooting out from it. I don't know if it's a real potato, but it's a potato mascot. Something similar to, you know, like the Pop-Tart Bowl, Pop-Tart mascot, rest in peace to that guy, or the Big Cheez-It, everything. Yeah, there's plenty that we have to get to, but first way I want to start, as we're talking about New Year's, I want to introduce you, because I don't know, since this is the way you celebrate it, you haven't watched Anderson Cooper and Andy Cohen's New Year's Eve celebrations before, have you?
Oh, maybe like years ago. I know it's... A good terminology, especially as the night goes on, is unhinged. I know Anderson and Andy, they definitely like to partake in adult beverages while they are on their during their broadcast. So it definitely gets wacky quick. So I would not be surprised if this year there was a lot of hijinks.
You know, I like that you said the running theme, the running word will be unhinged. I think that's going to be the running word for the year going into a big election year. Yeah, I think it's just going to be unhinged. But yes. You described their New Year's perfectly. I mean, if you're not doing anything on New Year's Eve, watching one of these shows, I mean, Ryan Seacrest's Dick Clark's Rockin' New Year's Eve is, you know, one thing that you can go to every year. You can always see Miley Cyrus or, you know, like Mariah Carey struggling to perform in the cold and all this shit. But you could go to Anderson Cooper and Andy Cohen on CNN, where they are allowed to drink on air for one night a year. Now, they weren't allowed to drink the last couple years, so it was kind of like a dry show, and people were complaining about
it. Is that a COVID rule or something?
It was like a new CNN president. Wanted
CNN.
It to be, yeah, he wanted them to be more
fake
professional.
News.
Well, I'll tell you what, it was real drinks this year. They brought it back. You take a shot at the start of every hour. So when this was going on,
I think it was
11 o'clock. I think they're three shots in, and who knows however many drinks left. As they go out to correspondent John Mayer out in Japan at a cat bar.
It's called Cats in the Box in Tokyo, celebrating New Year's. We're already halfway through the first day of 2024.
John.
I'm here with
John.
Shin and five other proprietors of the bar.
Talk to me about this bar. You're in the bar. And there are cats everywhere.
Yes.
They are licking each other.
There are cats.
Yes.
Yes, this is a...
And...
Yeah. This is a place you can come, enjoy a drink or two, and talk to cats. It's a cat bar. I mean, I don't know how much more clear I can be about the objective of this place.
John, you are in Tokyo,
I can't
Japan.
See Anderson, but I know exactly what he looks like.
Yes.
Yes, you do.
Yes, you do. He's gone. He's off with the fairies here. The shot of the cat's ass in your face is making him delirious.
I will say, I have seen many a broadcast with both Andy Cohen and Anderson Cooper, and I don't think I have ever heard a human being in my life have that just guttural laugh reaction to a cat bar. Maybe it's because John Mayer just has that like laid back, cool guy attitude. And he's like, what? It's I'm at a cat bar. Like, what's so funny? But it's just, that's too good.
That giggle is like the perfect way to start the year. Like, it was just a not, like, he couldn't stop. He couldn't stop giggling for the full minute and a half. And I think it's exactly what you said. It's just the absurdity. One, it's already like, it's almost 11:30 at night. You're like several shots into your night. And now you're watching a very serious John Mayer with a cat's ass in his face at a bar.
Right. Yeah. And it's just, we've all been there. I mean, there's been, oh shit, I almost dropped everything off my desk.
Okay, zoo.
I almost pulled a zoo. But no, like we've all had that reaction at some point in our time, at point in our lives where it can be the dumbest thing and it just perfectly plucks the humor string that you have internally with you. And it just kills you for minutes and you're just completely just incapacitated and you can't do anything else. Case in point.
Well, look, I mean, other ways to start off an unhinged 2024. I mean, there's been plenty of things already. Tyreek Hill's house was on fire. So he's on the injury report, I think, with literal in parentheses, house on fire. Kept him out of practice on there. Shit, Shannon Sharp apparently is now like the face of media. I guess he's like the place to go to for media. He went completely viral today with his latest interview on his show Club Shay Shay, which with Katt Williams.
Yep.
Yeah. Oh my God. It honestly makes me want to rename the show to like Club Riri and just get one of those on there so we can have like a little more period. But yeah, his interview with Katt Williams has gone completely viral. Legendary comedian, completely destroying any comedian, any great black comedian you can think of. And I guess you can argue with Katt Williams if they're actually great. He's talking about like Steve Harvey, who I believe he called. So he said Steve Harvey was wondering why he couldn't be a movie star. Katt Williams said it's because Hollywood doesn't want some country bumpkin who can't talk and looks like Mr. Potato Head.
Well, then he was even taking shots at like Cedric the Entertainer. He's like, you're supposed to go up there and sing and dance and like do all this stuff and be entertaining. And then we found out you're not entertaining.
Right.
You had four comedy specials that will never see the light of day because you're not funny.
I mean,
just an actor.
He had just brilliantly brutal attacks on just a random stray against Faison Love. Random stray on Faison Love.
No. Ran,
just a Jonathan Majors took massive shit from him for, and it wasn't even for the issues that got him fired from Marvel. But it was mostly because he just thought he was ugly. He didn't understand how Hollywood made him attractive. So,
well, then, like, what was it? Because I didn't watch the whole thing. I was just every once in a while I would find clips of the interview. And like there was a portion of it where like he was even like going off on like these comedians' wives, how like they just happen to always find some like light skinned woman who will never do an interview, and she's just there, like she just exists. Right.
Yeah, he said if you take that deal with the devil, everything you can look. He said he's not even calling anybody else in particular. He even brought Ludacris up in this. You take that deal with the Hollywood devil, and you're gonna wind up with a light skinned wife with an ugly face.
Speaking of light-skinned women with ugly faces, did you see a new Jada Pinkett Smith picture that just got released?
No, what happened there?
I'll send it to you.
Oh shit! How do you feel about Jada Pinkett Smith and Will? Do you are we feeling bad for Will anymore or
initially? Initially, but when you fall down the rabbit hole of Jada and Will, it seems like a lot of it is like self-inflicted, and he just sounds like he's a cuck. So, like, I don't really feel that bad for him, but, I mean, there's definitely moments where you feel bad for the dude, but at this point, like, you're a grown-ass man, you're multi-million-dollar actor, recording artist, rapper, you know, one of the biggest names in the world, like, if you wanted to walk away, you would walk away.
100%. He could have.
Men.
Oh, men.
Let's see if it's still on her Instagram. Hold on. Yeah, it's still there. She looks like Fat Joe if he lost like 200 pounds.
Keep Wait, where's the? Oh, where's the? Where's Chris Rock?
Oh, okay.
She does look like.
Oh, she looks like one of those Hollywood impersonators of like Pitbull.
She's
Mr. Worldwide.
She looks like she's about to drop the hottest album of 2007.
Oh my god. Gangnam Style took a huge nosedive.
Oh god. Like we said, unhinged. It's an unhinged 2024 that we're growing into.
We haven't even gotten anything for the show yet.
No, we actually haven't even touched the topic, and I think it's time. Look, one of the unhinged things as we get into this final week of the NFL regular season, which is crazy think of. This extended year. Look, it's been extra stressful for you because you didn't expect to have playoff hopes or get in anywhere with Tampa Bay. And now Tampa Bay's got you stressing out going into this last week of the season.
I think last week was probably when the first, because like every once in a while I can get their game on. I'll kind of play it on in the background while I'm doing stuff. But like last week I actually watched the game because I knew if they won, they would clinch. And of course, what did they do? They didn't win. So now we got it's a win and you're in kind of situation this week. So
how will you feel if they lose to the Panthers? Like you didn't have any expectations going into the season, but now you're here at this point and you're playing the shittiest team in one of the shittiest teams in history.
Yeah, I think I would be more upset that we lost to the Panthers and not so much lost out on like a playoff berth, if that makes any sense. Especially because a win for Carolina is not going to help Washington out at all right now. I mean, they already locked up the number one pick, so right. Chicago has that.
Well, when we're talking about disappointment, somebody that we have, you know, around this show, not Zoo, but our other good friend of John McCann. The Philly captain. Philly is in a little bit of a weird place right now. I don't know if you've been seeing any of their fan pages and all of that, but Nick Sirianni, head coach of the Philadelphia Eagles, is actually on what they're calling, quote, the warm seat. Like, he just took the Eagles to the Super Bowl last year, but according to fans, Philly analysts, he could probably not get fired this year. But he's got a strong case to be fired next year if improvement doesn't happen, even though they've had a very great season overall. The record has been incredible. They've, you know, skated in some games and mistakes have been made in other places. And now somehow Matt Patricia is running their defense out of nowhere. I don't know where that came from. But fans, analysts, they want good coaching changes to be made there by that team for him to change. You know, it's. He lost his offensive coordinator and his defensive coordinator last year. Shane Steichen and Jonathan Gannon have both gone on to very, very relatively impressive first years as head coaches. I'd say Jonathan Gannon has been pretty impressive with his tenure as the Cardinals, and they just completely upset the Eagles this past week in Week 17 and messed up chances to go ahead and take a hold on the NFC East or keep that charge in there. Let me ask you, are the team's failures this season fairly on Nick Sirianni?
No.
Where are they?
Absolutely not. No, I mean, you look at Nick Sirianni's record just in Philly, like for regional pundits and the fan base is coming out pretty much calling for his head at this point if he doesn't get the shit together next season. His first year in Philly, he went 9-8. And then 2022, he went 14-3. And then now, what are they, 11-5? It's like they're doing well. It's just, I think it's overinflated because it is Philly and Philly fans always feel like they're going to have the greatest teams in the whole world. I mean, look at between the Phillies and the Flyers and all the other fan bases that are in Philadelphia. It's just overinflated confidence from them. And it's not on him because, I mean, he's more of an offensive guy and their offense is doing considerably well. Their top 10 offense, you know, both, especially in the running game, I think a lot of their issues are on the defensive side of the ball. So this is where you're looking at Matt Patricia, who doesn't have the best track record outside of when he was with New England. But even when he was there, was he really calling the shots on defense or was it really Bill kind of leading the way? Because we saw what he was doing in Detroit when he was the head coach there. I mean, between him and then who's the actual DC that he has now? Sean Desai,
but apparently he's at some point a couple weeks ago, they started asking him to take more of a backseat role. and move back. I guess they've been kind of phasing him out. They didn't like the direction that the defense was going or play calling was going under him. Apparently Matt Patricia is now in charge of their defense.
Right. And I mean, I think a lot of it too is like you're seeing a lot of these teams being able to adapt year over, like a lot faster year over year, like going up against them. Because last year, they were damn near unstoppable all last year. And even if you look at this year, a lot of these wins that they do have, I mean, they only beat the Patriots by 5. They only beat the Commanders by 3. So like a lot of these wins were still ones they kind of like squeaked by. There's not really an oppressive win even on here. And I think that's more of a testament to the league itself, where me and you, we talk about this all the time about there's more parity in sports now than there ever was. And it's only going to, that gap is only going to keep closing. And I think this is what you're seeing is a lot of these teams being able to adapt to their schemes, and maybe he has to adapt to and do something a little bit different, but maybe that's why he's been relying so much on the tush push play with everything. You know, I mean, it is what it is.
Well, and I think we brought this up in the preseason show, or Zoo brought this up about Sirianni and, you know, the loss of those play callers on both sides for him. And it's this thing where when Sirianni was first hired, we played the sound in our salute to Philly. It's one of our favorites of him, of Sirianni's opening press conference, where he cannot put together a sentence to save his life and cannot give any like reasonable answer to what is the team's, you know, formula here. He's not that kind of guy. He's not the big brains guy. He's kind of Dan Campbell-ish, where he's going to get you hyped up. He's going to, you know, be cussing out Chiefs fans going through the tunnel and all this shit. So when you take away his best play callers and you're trying to replace him the very next year, of course you can expect some type of drop off and some type of issues there. The fact that the team is still 11-5, I think it's pretty unfair to start throwing out, you know, hot seat accusations at him. But Philly, and particularly that owner, Jeffrey Lurie, and the GM, Howie Roseman, they aren't necessarily the most patient people. And we've seen that over time. You know, with Andy Reid, they had plenty of years with Andy Reid, but once things got stale, let him go, it kind of worked out for both sides. Both wound up winning a Super Bowl in their respective areas. But Doug Peterson, who's the coach, or second after that, Chip Kelly replaced Andy Reid and got rid of Chip Kelly when you realized that shit was a fad. Doug Peterson replaced him, won a Super Bowl. Next couple of years, loyalty to assistant coaches that weren't really doing what he needed to get done there. And who took the hit? Super Bowl winning head coach. Fired Doug Peterson, got him out of there. I think Sirianni, they're going to have a serious conversation with him at the end of the season, because at this point, I don't know how well they do in the playoffs. I could easily see them being a one and done here in the playoffs, the way that defense is just getting completely maneuvered. But also on the offensive side of the ball, something that worked for them so well last year was the RPO, the run pass option, where they were already getting blitzed heavy, but they use that RPO and it fits right into Jalen Hurts' skill set. That mobility where he can, you know, fake it to, at that time, Miles Sanders. You can either, you know, get the option there. Am I going to hand it off to him? Am I going to take it off myself? Or am I going to throw it? And it was working. It was working tremendously. This year, that stat line on the RPO has dropped tremendously. They have not utilized that under the new offensive coordinator. And you'd argue you could want to use it more when you have an actual great running back in DeAndre Swift back there. And the fact that fans have been calling for that for about 3 months now to bring back that RPO, and, you know, nothing is working, nothing is going towards that. They have been pretty steadfast in what their offensive scheme is going to be this year. Jalen Hurts himself seemed kind of a little agitated a couple weeks ago during his press conference, saying that people weren't bought in, and they at first thought he was talking about other players, but it could have been coaches that he was talking about in there. So I think Lurie, Roseman, they'll have a serious conversation with him, with Sirianni, at the end of the season to see where the direction of this team is headed. Hey, what kind of changes are you going to make on the coaching staff and scheme-wise for next season? And if he can't get something worked up, I could easily, and this team, you know, goes on about the same projection next year It's not the same thing in Dallas where Jerry Jones just lets Jason Garrett and Mike McCarthy ruin a franchise and waste its time for years. Philly will get him the fuck out of there and move on to somebody else really quick.
Right, and you bring up a good point, especially with Dougie P. I completely forgot about, you know, the way they treated him after that Super Bowl victory. You know, you had a mediocre season leading up after that, and just like you said, they just cut the dead weight and keep on moving. Like you said, you know, they're not an ownership group or a GM who's going to give you a lot of leash. It's either you're going to perform and you're going to perform well, or you're out. And especially because one person I feel that probably would be a really good fit for the Eagles, say if they did end up getting rid of Sirianni this offseason for whatever reason, would be Ravens DC Mike McDonald.
Yes.
I mean, you see a lot of RPO going on in Baltimore. You can easily bring that into Philly. And then, you know, his defense in Baltimore is outstanding. You know, they really do a really good job there in Baltimore. So bringing that kind of mindset to Philly would probably be a good thing.
Absolutely. I agree with you. Now, moving on to a different area, not about a playoff team at all, but they were slightly on the edge. The Chicago Bears. What a turnaround they made here in the second half of the season. You could almost attribute it to their Pro Bowler Montez Sweat. As soon as they traded for him, he never made a Pro Bowl with Washington. As soon as he gets there, all of a sudden he is like literally saving Matt Eberflus's job there in Chicago. But now you have the case where they are 7-9 at this point, but it doesn't matter ultimately with their first round pick. They have the Carolina Panthers first round pick. They are locked in to the number one pick overall in this coming draft. So, of course, all the arguments have already begun, and they will last for months unless somebody in Chicago answers it and spares us. Do the Bears keep Justin Fields or trade him away and take Caleb Williams, presumably, at number one this year? I will ask you that exact... I don't even want to ask it that exact way because it's going to be this variation of this question no matter what all over. So let me just get your opinion here and see where you fall in line with me. Justin Fields or Caleb Williams, who would you rather have going into next season?
Fields.
You would rather have Fields. What has proven himself to you?
I don't think it's so much that it's what he's proven. I think it goes towards more Caleb Williams, because a lot of if you follow college football and especially a lot of these prospects coming out into the draft, there are some character concerns that are starting to bubble up now with Caleb Williams, especially with that locker room. I mean, we saw how well they did in their bowl game, and there was a lot of like chirping that was kind of like underhanded chirping against Caleb Williams from the players who actually played that game. And then you see a lot of the same things with work ethic and just, you know, what's the, not killer mentality, that's not the way I want to word it, but like, it's just, he doesn't have that X factor that you're kind of looking for and leadership qualities that you're looking for out of a quarterback. And especially going back to what we talked about earlier about parity in sports. I mean, it feels like every year there's a new generational quarterback coming out. So like for me, if my choice is rolling the dice on another quarterback, whether it's Drake May or Caleb Williams or Michael Penix Jr. or somebody, would I rather roll the dice and try to get a franchise quarterback then, or keep compiling draft capital and drafting all these pieces year in and year out? Because honestly, if they traded back from one to like, I don't know, to New England at three, they want to jump Washington for Caleb Williams, you're going to damn near get the same package that you got from Carolina last year from another team. So you're going to keep stacking extra one, like first round picks year in and year out, if you just keep doing this. And a quarterback's going to come in your lap at some point.
And I understand that with Caleb Williams, and it's scary for me as a Washington fan. I saw Caleb Williams accidentally quote, like a tweet that was saying the Bears should pass on him and take Marvin Harrison Jr. And, you know, cause at that point last week, Washington was, you know, creeping into that number two pick. Caleb Williams is a Washington Commanders fan, has been lifelong. He's from DC. So I think preferably he would like to come here, but it's just tough to me with the Chicago thing on Justin Fields, because Fields does have the talent. We see that. We see the ability. We've known it since the time at Ohio State, but it's just those games where it does not, like, it's not falling on, you can't use the excuse of the O-line or his receivers in some right. of these games. It's literally like he doesn't know how to play the position. Like, he just has mental lapses sometimes. And I don't know. I like the ceiling of Caleb Williams so much, and adding that to the point that you can get him cheaper than what Fields is going to be in like 2 years. Caleb Williams will be cheaper at that point just because you're resetting the cap on your quarterback and drafting somebody brand new.
Yeah, no, and I'm looking at this the draft list too. I mean, there's plenty of people, like, so let's, for all intents and purposes, Chicago, they pick up Marvin Harrison Jr., yes. number one overall.
Mm-hmm.
You guys are sitting there at two.
Yeah.
And you have your pick of the litter. You can do whatever you want. You have Sam Howell already.
Uh-huh.
So, like, but what if there's a team that's a couple picks after you guys who are kind of in that same situation right now that Chicago is about to have to do with Fields, and that's the Chargers and Justin Herbert. And they're trying to hit the reset button right now and trying to get rid of things. Would you be willing to package some kind of deal with a number two overall pick to trade down with the Chargers to get Herbert to come to Washington?
100%. Yeah, I would take Herbert in a second. I think he is legit on that status. I don't think the Chargers would do that. But I've also been shocked by a lot more in the NFL. So,
right.
Yeah, I would take that 100%. I mean, the case that I've actually been thinking more of is, let's say Carolina or Chicago does take Marvin Harrison Jr. or whatever, and Caleb Williams is available there at number two. I would actually, right now you have Vegas at number 11, Minnesota at 12. I don't like those as much, but Atlanta at 9 and could move up a little bit based off of what happens this coming week. Tennessee at number 7, Jets at 8. I don't think they'll go after somebody with Aaron Rodgers, you know, supposedly coming back.
Mm-mm.
Giants at 5. There are teams that I could be okay with us trading back for a haul and,
right.
you know, passing up on the Caleb Williams thing just because of how much else we need. Marvin Harrison would fit one of those bigger needs right now. So with him off the table, I mean, Caleb Williams, I definitely believe is better than Sam Howell and will be better than Sam Howell will ever be at any point in his career. But yeah, I would take the haul right now instead of Caleb Williams.
Right. Well, because, and it's also been proven, like, year in and year out, that, like, is it nice to have a franchise quarterback who can kind of put everything on his shoulders and just game manage and do what he needs to do? Absolutely. But, like, for me, like, I feel that it's more important to make sure the supporting cast is set in place and you have the pieces there, so that way when you do end up bringing that rookie phenom quarterback in there, he has already established weapons. He has an established O-line. He doesn't have to worry about scrambling around like a crazy person.
Right.
Like Howell's been having to do right now with all the O-line issues there in Washington. So, like, that's where Washington, you trade back with one of these teams that would pull the trigger on a quarterback. You stay in that top 10. You get one of these big tackles to come up and you still have another pick. You're still getting a haul.
If I'm Chicago at this point, in the draft status stays where it is currently, I would be phoning New England if they're staying at number 3 to try and get them to move up. Just whatever you can give, you know, whatever, you know, extra picks. If there's a bidding war, they could probably get a first rounder for next year too.
They trade Belichick to Chicago.
Could. Yeah, I mean, you could just to get in there. But I think that would be their best spot and the best potential that they could get from anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, that's, if I'm Chicago right now and I'm figuring out what I want to do at one, I'm so certain that I'm not making a pick there. I'm just waiting to see, like you said, see where the standings flesh out, see where the draft order is going to be looking like. And I'm starting to make calls like day one.
Right. 100%.
Like, I'm not making a pick. Because like I said, you can do this year in and year out. Like, you're not trading your number one pick. You're picking up theirs. So, like, you could hypothetically have two first round picks every year from now till eternity if you just keep flipping that pick to bad teams who are always going to be like how Carolina was this year. They were in the number one overall spot.
It's the Houston Rockets method. It's what the Houston Rockets have been doing in the NBA and the Oklahoma City Thunder. Like, they just keep flipping picks and flipping great players for these picks. I mean,
right.
I guess it could work.
And it resets those rookie deals every single time.
Right.
you know, like you're always bringing in some kind of rookie, but I don't know. I guess there's a reason why they're paid the big bucks and I just sit here and pay to be on a show.
Well, hey, look, talking about paying to be on a show, it's not on our docket, but it's we brought him up and I'm curious your thoughts on Aaron Rodgers and Aaron Rodgers Tuesdays on the Pat McAfee show. Now, we have this is Scott Ellia Thursdays that we have on here, but you don't go out and accuse, you know, somebody else in the network like Zoo of being a pedophile. Not on the air.
Well.
I mean, not on the air. That's the group chat to his face. But that is exactly what Aaron Rodgers did on the Pat McAfee show this past Tuesday, where he's talking about, for whatever reason, the Epstein Island, Jeffrey Epstein list of clients that's supposed to be released by the end of the month at some point. And for whatever reason, he brought up Jimmy Kimmel. He said wait till you see Jimmy Kimmel on this list. I think it's because Jimmy Kimmel was making jokes about Rodgers getting concussed leading to the ayahuasca stuff. That there's some type of bitter stuff there. But Rodgers made that joke about him. Kimmel did not take kindly to it. And it wasn't like he was, you know, roasting him back or joking back at him about it. He was threatening straight up legal action on a, you know, they're owned by the same family. They're owned on the Disney family. So Rodgers continuing to talk out of his ass. Like, he loves his freedom of speech. But the shit that he's been saying about, you know, whether it's with vaccines or something about Kelsey or now about Kimmel and, you know, potentially being on a pedophile island. Like, my question is, do you think Rodgers would be this way if he had gotten the Jeopardy job? I think because I've been enjoying pinpointing exactly where people have lost it.
Is that when his villain arc started, when he got denied Jeopardy?
Antonio Brown's started when he got hit by James Harrison in that playoff game against the Bengals when he was still a Steeler. Aaron Rodgers, I think either, I'm trying to pinpoint it to either he lost the Jeopardy job and that's when he just decided, fuck it, I'm going to say whatever I want now. Or Mike McCarthy drove him insane, because if he had like or three Super Bowls, I don't think he'd be this way. I don't think he would need to find himself this deeply.
Well, I think the control on that is going to be Mike McCarthy. We got to start watching Dak to see what's happening. See if he starts slipping a little bit.
I mean, Dak has been shaving his happens. Head. He's been shaving his head like really religiously, even though like you can see the hairs there. I don't know. Like, he's getting that kind of weird, you know, Mr. Unlimited vibes a little bit, that kind of like Russell Wilson vibes in press conferences. So yeah, maybe.
No, I like your thought process around Jeopardy. That would be enough to set anybody down the rabbit hole and just have a spiral of their life happening.
Now, another team that Rodgers has familiarity with, and we'll close out with them as we go into Ricks versus Gricks, and that is the Detroit Lions, who congratulations to them. On, you know, they won their division for the first time in, God knows, I think like 30 years or something like that. They'll be hosting a playoff game for the first time in 30 plus years. And their head coach, Dan Campbell, look, I think it was talked ad nauseum right after it happened on that Saturday night game between the Lions and the Cowboys, where there was a 2-point attempt by the Lions. Reportedly, their O-lineman, Taylor Decker, was supposed to have reported himself. You have to report when you're going to be a... O-lineman cannot catch the ball on their own. They have to report to the ref that they're going to be a eligible receiver. Their O-lineman that did make the catch, the game-winning catch, was apparently not reported in. There was another O-lineman that had reported in, but the Lions are saying that they did. NFL was saying that the Lions are trying to be tricky and cheat and everything. I don't know. All in all, they had like 3 2-point attempts. They didn't get any of the other two after that. And I will play for you first Dan Campbell's appearance on a radio show, a local Detroit radio show, where things got a little awkward because I think you and I would be, we would be the same way. We would fold. If we're attempting to confront Dan Campbell on something, man Campbell, you don't want to get you don't want him angry at you. And this is how it went when these radio hosts brought up the idea that they think the extra 2-point attempts might have been a bad idea.
When you got the penalty and moved it to
go ahead and say it. Say it. Both of you.
What?
Say it. Say what you want to say.
I think from the 7, it's a low percentage play. I think your chances of winning are lower than if you kick the extra point.
I would have like you would say it to anybody else. I'm on the radio. Say it like you want to say it.
Yeah. I thought it was a reckless decision.
Thank you.
But you don't regret it?
No.
Okay. That's fair.
No.
Do you think it was a reckless decision at all? What do you make of this entire blunt? Everything that happened, what do you make of it?
It just further instills my belief that there should not be any human element as far as referees go in any major league, in any major sports across the world. Like, there's no reason for them to be there on the field. You could easily do that same thing as far as checking in a player or have an O-line check in with somebody. They're going to be an eligible receiver just as easily face to face as you can calling up to a box somewhere. And you go back and you relook at that footage and it's clear to see what happens. You see number 70 running on the field. The ref is looking at number 70, but what's the other guy's number? It's like 54 or 64.
68. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, he's the one who's actually checking in. So 68's talking to us, hey, 68's checking in, but the ref's looking at 70, so he hears it, but he's looking at him, and all these refs are fucking boomers, and they don't know what the hell's going on half the time. God, I mean, they take up half the shopping aisle when you're shopping. God forbid you're in a high-pressure situation. You got to make a really quick decision and make the right decision. That's another problem. But no, that's something that should have never happened, and I feel terrible for the Lions and for Dan Campbell. I don't feel like it was a regular decision because, you know, honestly, it worked once. It could work again. I mean, they proved they could have done it.
No.
Oh, sorry, Dan.
Thank you.
No, I'm with you on the human element of it. That's just the fact that the ref was confused as hell. Like, he obviously was just confused. I think it's why, like, at first I thought, like, he obviously just, like, fucked this up and he doesn't want to own up to it. But
you can't do it, though. Like, you can't be like, oh, yeah, I fucked up, but sorry.
Right. And, like, it had us looking up rules. Like, it had us looking up the commissioner's, you know, power as to whether he can overturn a game or not. But ultimately, like, I think you have to also take into account that there was 34 seconds left in that game. Dak Prescott and CeeDee Lamb were unstoppable. There's no telling what would have happened in those 34 seconds, even if they had gotten the 2 points. And I think it was just the fact that they got moved back to the 7-yard line and Campbell still was insistent on going for the 2-point conversion. Like, at that point, dude, like, and when it happened the third time and things got jumbled up again and boom, you get a third shot at it, go with God. God is telling you to take the extra point.
Like, he's like, just kick the ball.
Kick the ball. That's why you have him. Like, just kick the ball.
Yeah, but it's hindsight's always, you know, hindsight's always 20/20. You're always going to have that Monday morning, you know, armchair quarterback. You know, you should have done this situation. Because what if Dan Campbell did decide, okay, you know, let's go for the field goal this time. They send the field goal, trot him out there, and he misses the field goal.
Thank you.
He's like, oh, fuck, I should have just gone for it again. So it's like, there's no coming back from that call. There's no coming back because you can't fix it in the moment. What's his name? What was it? Brad. I know his first name is Brad. Of course it is. Brad Allen, I think it's Brad Allen was the official who did that.
Yeah.
Like, you, there's no correcting it because even if you admit, oh yeah, my bad, I was looking at 70. We just went and looked at the replay and I see he actually had talked it to me. So we're picking the flag up. You got the 2 points because then the Cowboys sideline is going to blow a load and they're going to get pissed about something.
Right.
And nobody wants the Cowboys blowing loads.
No.
Well,
let's get into Ricks versus Gricks.
Life. Death. Time. Space. Forget everything you think you know. Put your money on the line. It's time for Ricks versus Gricks. Gricks?
That's right. Ricks versus Gricks. Reed's picks versus Griffin's picks. Griffin is up there in the corner looking down on us as the watcher of all football picks. Scott Ellia is here, still competing to be this year's Grick. And I mean, look, we're doing all right with picks this year. I think percentage-wise, like, Zoo is really making this show look like we know what we're doing out here. But
yep.
Last week, Zoo went 3-3. He is still on the leaderboard here at 64-38 going into this last week of the regular season. I went 5-1. I said I would, and I did it. I came back. I'm 5-1. I am 60-42 on the season. Scott, you are in third place still. You went 2-4 last week, unfortunately. You are now 54-48. Luis, Big Chief Burrito, host of Mi Gente Show, SoCal Tattoo, if you're out there. He went 3-3. He is also 54-48 on this season. And this week was a little bit, it was tough. Some tough games to pick out, honestly. You have most, like, a huge crop of games. There's still a lot of playoff implications going around. And we're going to start with one game that has a team that's still fighting to make a playoff appearance and one that's already locked it up. They've locked up the AFC as the, you know, what city is this conference going to go through? That is the Pittsburgh Steelers, who are 9-7 at their division rival, the Baltimore Ravens, who are 13-3. Ravens will be resting the majority of their starters, including Lamar Jackson, who is looking to be the MVP. I think it would be his second MVP if he wins this. Pittsburgh, at that point, is a 3.5-point favorite in this game. Scott, who do you want?
I'm interested to see if they're going to get their newly signed running back, Dalvin Cook, back there to get him warmed up a little bit before the playoffs. That'd be fun to see him in some purple and black.
That's a big get.
Huge. That's a huge piece that they've kind of been missing for a while. Their running back room seems to be always in shambles as far as injuries go. But if I'm the Ravens, regardless if I'm sitting my starters or not, you look to see which of these AFC teams are still alive as far as their playoff berth goes, and you're trying to figure out who would you rather play. And between the Colts, the Texans, and the Steelers. And I think the Steelers are at the bottom of that list. I feel like the other two you'd rather play over Pittsburgh and having that rivalry game potentially later down the road. So give me the Ravens to completely squander Steelers fans.
I am running with you 100% on this one. I think that, you know, if you want to see a team in the playoffs, it's the Steelers. Colts and Texans, you can't necessarily trust. They're overperforming more than you would expect this season, especially with Gardner Minshew in Indianapolis. Steelers, they can't seem to even figure out what's going on at quarterback. So, yeah, even with Baltimore rolling out Tyler Huntley as their starter, who led them, you know, into the playoffs last year with whatever was going on with Lamar, I still don't – I think it could be a good chance that Pittsburgh still fucks it up. But, you know, they've already clinched their winning record for the year. And, you know, Mike Tomlin goes another year without getting a losing record. So
celebrating mediocrity as usual.
Yes. Baltimore, I don't think that they will really care that much this year. It's more of just like a little warm-up game for the backups and probably for Dalvin Cook. So give me Pittsburgh in this one. But while we're here, I want to talk about Lamar Jackson really quick and the greatness that this season has been. And I want to display that with a little bit of a video here for you. I don't know if you saw this last week and they're just absolute crushing of Miami. But this play right here by Lamar Jackson. You see Lamar starts out, look at that, left. He starts out like a left-handed quarterback, fakes it for a huge touchdown to Zay Flowers. And it's just crazy. It's crazy, yeah, the mentality that he has. And you're going to see right here on that bottom side, watch the corners. When he's doing that left-handed, there we go, a little helpful thing, completely fucks him up.
Right.
He knew exactly what he was doing. And this is a guy that Bill Polian said should be a wide receiver.
Jesus. No, I think that's just a testament to that his athletic ability, to where a cornerback in the NFL should understand the drop back procedure of a quarterback if they're right-handed or left-handed. So if you're seeing Lamar drop back like he's left-handed, don't believe it. Like, he's going to have to turn his body to throw the ball, unless he's just some ambidextrous wonder child who can throw the ball both ways, which I wouldn't put it past him if he couldn't throw left-handed. He probably could still throw farther than I could right-handed.
Yeah, and I think it's just that thing. That I think it's respect for his play, and that they would, you know, they're seeing that, and they're like, oh, shit, he's going to do something. Like, why not? He's already just fucking with us at this point. So I'm happy for the dude. I'm happy that he's going to get this second MVP. If he gets his second MVP, he's Hall of Famer, right? Has to be.
Yeah.
I think there was a stat.
Especially if he locks up a second MVP and he gets a Super Bowl victory this year, absolutely. There's no question.
I don't think that there, I think I tried looking it up, and I, from everything I saw, there is not one quarterback that's won two MVPs that isn't in the Hall of Fame, including the two current, there are two current ones that will probably make the Hall of Fame, Aaron Rodgers, of course, and Patrick Mahomes. So yeah. Lamar, that Super Bowl will help, but my God, what a incredible career he's made for himself here in Baltimore. Next game up, we brought these two up. That is the Houston Texans, who are 9-7, at the Indianapolis Colts, who are 9-7 as well. Houston is a 1-point favorite. Both teams are playing for a playoff push, potentially to even win the division if Jacksonville really fucks it up. So who do you want here, Scott?
Yeah, this one's probably like the tougher one of the list that you sent out for me to pick, because like I'm just torn internally. Like, do I want to go with CJ Stroud, and who I feel is going to end up getting the Offensive Rookie Player of the Year? And if they do get a playoff berth and get a playoff win, you know, there's a good conversation for CJ Stroud to have that MVP at this point. Or do I want to trust Pascot and roll with the Colts and keep my super early Super Bowl prediction alive? And when all else fails, you got to trust yourself. And I'm going with the Colts over the Texans to get into the playoffs.
That's your Super Bowl team, man. I mean, you got to roll with them. You have to go. They haven't disappointed you yet this year. Look, a team that Colts have fucked with me in some of these picks, so I can't really, I can't say the same. But the Houston Texans, I have just enjoyed so much this year with CJ Stroud at quarterback. He is finally back. He's back to that performance level that you want to see. I would assume it's probably going to win Offensive Rookie of the Year, but we'll see. And that connection with Nico Collins, who I am just haunted by weekly of trading in my fantasy league, now that you and I are going up against each other here in this 2-week championship. And I could really use him this week. I really could. But altogether, it's just the Texans are just, they're just an overwhelming, very fun offense. Even on defense, their other pick, their other first round pick, Will Anderson, has set a record for their team in sacks. So give me the Texans to finish off a magical season and get into the playoffs for the first time since losing the Predator over in Cleveland. A game of pain for me here. The Dallas Cowboys, who are 11-5, still trying to clinch the NFC East. They are at the Washington Commanders, who are 4-12. Dallas is a 13-point favorite in this game. Scott, who do you want?
Yeah, there. I, as much as I want to keep taking these home run shots of I told you so's, you got to always bet on the little guy, I just can't do it. Especially with Tankathon still rolling high right now in Washington for that number two pick. They got to lose. So give me the Cowboys.
The Toyota Tankathon. Look, I know my gut tells me Dallas. Thanksgiving tells me Dallas in this one, but it's the Tankathon that really gets in my head here. And it's more than likely going to be Ron Rivera's last game. Obviously, the players aren't going to be playing for him. I don't think they really give a shit. Jahan Dotson's already talking about needing a culture change. That's what the issue is there. But something is telling me that they are going to fuck around. Sam Howell is going to ball out in this, you know, last opportunity to show that he should be the starter for this team next year. And I think that Washington's going to mess around and pick up a win here against Dallas and further muddle things up for the NFC East. So give me Washington.
Well, and it's even more difficult to make that decision because the Cowboys, they need to play their starters so they can lock up the actual division.
Yes.
But the Eagles play at the same exact time. I feel like if the Eagles played the 1 o'clock game, that would be more telling as far as what direction Dallas would go in.
And I wonder if they'll even keep the score up in FedEx, if they'll keep the Eagles score in there to fuck with them, or if Philly's winning, they'll keep the score up. If Philly's losing, they just blank it. That would be my guy.
Like, that'd be fun. I'd like it.
Another division rivalry game here to end the season. That is the Chicago Bears, who are 7-9, at the Green Bay Packers, who are 8-8. Green Bay is a 3-point favorite here, and they are still attempting to make the playoffs. They can get into a wild card spot with a win here over the Bears. Justin Fields made an attempt at trash talking Packers fans by saying that they're going to be loud because they have nothing else to do in Green Bay except watch football. And that would be trash talk for 31 other cities, except for Green Bay, where it's literally their truth. So who do you want here in this this big rivalry game, Scott?
This pick will be in honor of the great Emily Sissel. I am actually going to roll with Chicago. I'm going to take Chicago selfishly because I need Green Bay to lose. So that way it gives the Vikings the best chance possible to squeak back into the playoffs.
You want them? Oh, so you can take them. Look, I like selfishness. I'm also going with Emily Sissel's Bears here. I think that it's Justin Fields' last best shot at showing that he should be the Bears quarterback, not just auditioning for, you know, the Falcons like last week. DJ Moore, his superstar wide receiver, vouched for him this week, put his name on it, said that he wants Fields as his quarterback next year. So I'm taking – the Packers have just been so inconsistent. They looked great last week, but I think that's where, you know, the roller coaster goes right back. Bears will take it in their season, just like last year how the Lions did it to them. These division rivals, they love doing that shit to the Packers.
Well, especially if this will be huge for Justin Fields if they come out with the win, because that would mean they would have won the last 5 out of 6 games.
Yes. Yeah.
So it's like they've been on a really great stretch since midseason. So yeah, that'd be huge for him to get this win.
And it's kind of what happened last year to them too. That was the same kind of stretch. So, and they're gonna roll it back with Matt Eberflus. A lot of these teams are apparently just going to roll it back. Arthur Smith is apparently coming back for the Falcons.
Ew.
Todd Bowles will come back for the Bucks, you know, if they make the playoffs. So, and Dennis
you know
Allen,
who's not
I think.
Coming back?
Who?
Your boy.
Oh, yeah.
Brant Staley.
Oh, yeah. Thank God. And Josh McDaniels.
Oh. Hey.
Hey, speaking of asshole, the Denver Broncos, who are 8-8, they are going up against the Las Vegas Raiders, who are 7-9. Vegas is a 3-point favorite in this game. Broncos can still make a playoff push here. So, Scott, who are you going to take here? And this is, we haven't talked about the Broncos since Russell Wilson got benched. Mm-hmm. We haven't talked about them on this show. Russell Wilson getting benched for financial reasons. He made that very clear, too. NFLPA jumped into it, and they are not happy about it, and definitely said that could be some legal action against the Broncos and the NFL, which would be tremendous to me if, as Russell Wilson is leaving the Broncos, they lose another draft pick because of him. So, in this game of asshole Sean Payton against the former asshole Raiders, who are now pretty fun with Antonio Pierce, who do you want?
Yeah, and it's a game of just irrelevancy. Like, there's nothing on the line. Both teams are eliminated from playoff contention, so now they're just playing for pride. So it's like, I think the person who has the most to gain from a win is Antonio Pierce. It to completely try to solidify his reasoning to take over full-time head coach for the Las Vegas Raiders. So for the first time all season, give me the not for real Raiders.
Hey. Oh, look at that. That always brings up this great question.
This is something we ask everybody all the time, and if you answer it how our co-host Scott usually would answer it, you get it correct. Okay. Are the Raiders for real?
Oh, no, they suck.
Oh, overly enthusiastic, Griffin. I am actually going to roll with you here. I'm taking the Las Vegas Raiders and Antonio Pierce. I think this is Pierce's, you know, just like we said, you got cases. If you don't have a playoff push, then you have something to try and prove. Antonio Pierce is trying to prove that he should be their coach. He has been a awesome, awesome presence for them. Kind of reminds me of a Dan Campbell-like coach, but he fits that Raiders attitude so much. Christmas Day game, he had to like physically reel one of his corners back out because they were talking so much shit that it was about to just launch an all-out brawl on Christmas Day against the Chiefs. I like the guy. I also think that it's just good for the Broncos to lose. We got Taylor Swift. We haven't made a Taylor Swift reference all day. Karma is good. A coach on the Broncos. That's what's happening there. They're going to lose for Sean Payton. Ah, that asshole. So give me the Raiders in this one. Final game of Ricks versus Gricks in the regular season. The Buffalo Bills. This is the Sunday night premier game. Buffalo Bills, who are 10-6, are at the Miami Dolphins, who are 11-5. Buffalo is a 3-point favorite here on the road. Miami, pretty much the winner of this game, will win the AFC East. And honestly, if the Bills lose, they could still possibly lose out on a playoff spot. It's incredible. So, Scott, who is going to win the AFC East here, the Bills or the Dolphins?
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy that the Bills are opening up at 3-point favorites on the road, especially going against a Miami team that's only lost once at home all season. And that was by, like, what, 1 or 2 points to Tennessee a couple weeks ago?
Mm-hmm.
And even that game was really weird. I think there was a couple of people that were injuries for that game or something was going on. But I'm interested to see where Tyreek Hill's head's going to be at, because I know he's currently busy fighting fires down there in South Beach.
Yeah.
And I guess official came out saying it was a child with a lighter started the house fire at Tyreek Hill's house. So
wonderful.
I guess there's more to come there. So fire safety, folks. Teach your kids not to play with lighters. But this goes back to the Raiders game. It's like, who has the most to gain? Because the Dolphins essentially already locked up a playoff spot. All it's deciding now is that they win the division. The Bills need to win, and they've actually been playing really well down the stretch. So, you know what? Give me Josh Allen. Give me my starting white quarterback, Josh Allen, going to South Beach, winning the division on the road.
You know what? I am also... Well, am I? This has been one I've been going back and forth on because it's so tough, right? It's just like you said, like, what is there to play for? And I think the thing with Miami is they've clinched that playoff spot, but winning this game would give them home field advantage for at least one round. I think Miami needs to be at home in these playoffs. I don't like them on the road. I don't like them on the road, especially in like Buffalo. I don't like them being a wild card team. And even in Kansas City. So I think Miami really needs this, but the injuries are a big issue. Their defense, it was already kind of mid, but they're really torn up now. They've lost their pass rush completely with Bradley Chubb tearing his ACL, being out for the rest of the season, along with their, you know, previous pass rusher, Jalen Phillips. They're banged up all over the place there. Tua's shoulder has still been acting up a little bit. I don't know. There were issues last week. Buffalo, like you said, they're hot and cold, but they've been really hot. And when Josh Allen is hot and turned up, like I think he has 15 rushing touchdowns this season, you can't stop the dude. If he's really feeling it and he's really motivated, he's turned on for this game, then I don't think you stop him at all. So I am taking the Buffalo Bills here. But I am curious on the Miami side to see what their defense does. I think that this is kind of the game that you... got Jalen Ramsey for. You paid all that money for him. This is where you try to get the most out of him. So we'll see what happens. Yeah, I like,
especially being embarrassed last week against the Ravens on the road. Like, they have to correct the issues now.
I liked what somebody said with Tyreek Hill's house fire. Had anybody seen Sean McDermott anywhere? Was he running around from the scene? Did he take
his 9/11 speech? In a Buffalo Bill jersey, just running out there. just see Bill's Mafia just setting houses on fire.
I watched one of their fans catch on fire during their tailgate last week. So, what
I'm reading the official statement. A fire at the $6.9 million home owned by Miami Dolphins receiver Tyreek Hill was started by a child playing with a cigarette lighter in a bedroom. It was an accidental fire.
Well, I mean,
have lighters laying around.
Wouldn't be Tyreek's worst incident with a child.
Oh.
Transition. It's time to make some money, folks, with the 3-2-3.
Calvin Ridley Bettingslip.
That's right, Ridley. Folks. It's the Calvin Ridley Calvin Memorial Ridley. Betting Slip.
Calvin.
Where Scott Ellia is going to try to make you millions, or at least thousands. Or, I don't know, you can maybe get your money back. Just depends on how it goes. Where he's going to give you the parlay that you need. Just absolutely ridiculous. I mean, we started with props. We had to transition back to just going on games because we weren't doing well on those. I had a really good parlay, just a full prop bet parlay last week. I thought it was great. It died in the first slate of games with Christian McCaffrey not scoring a touchdown. But what do you got to do? So what do you have for us this week, Scott? What are you going to make us? How many games did you have to pick here?
We picked all 16 this week, Reed. We went because games are on Saturday and Sunday. And it seems fitting to go out with a bang for the last one of the season. Not to say that the betting slip will not continue going into the playoffs, Reed.
Oh,
I'm sure it'll be nice to tip my hand there that this isn't the last time you'll be hearing this betting slip. But this is probably going to be the one that's going to make you potentially the most money. The history is not in favor of Scott's picks because Scott's picks have never won these parlays. But hey, it's the last one. You gotta make the bet.
That's right.
You can't win the bet if you don't make the bet.
No.
Who are making the bet this week? And we're rolling out with the first Ricks versus Gricks picks of the Ravens over the Pittsburgh Steelers. Next up on the slate is the Texans versus the Colts. We're rolling with the Colts. Buccaneers on the road against Carolina Panthers. We're going to take Scott's Bucks to lock up that playoff spot this year. Jacksonville Jaguars on the road against Tennessee Titans. Reed, there is some heat rising there in Nashville, in Tennessee, and potentially Mike Vrabel being moved on from. Have you heard these rumors yet?
I haven't heard that. I thought he hadn't ripped off his own dick yet to make the playoffs. So I wasn't sure.
Yep, there's a little bit of grumbling, so do not be shocked if the offseason gets here and he is gone. But I'm going to give it to Tennessee. I'm going to give it to them on the road. They're not on the road. They're going to give it to them at home. They play decently well at home, so give me them. Rolling into the future Super Bowl winning team, the Minnesota Vikings. They are going to win this week against the Detroit Lions. Rude. Atlanta Falcons versus New Orleans Saints. Rise up, Anthony Mackie, because the Falcons are taking this one.
Rise up, baby!
Browns at the Bengals. Another irrelevant game. The Browns have already locked up their playoff berth. The Bengals are just trying to get past this week. But give me the Bengals. Give me the Bengals to shock everybody. They're 7-point underdogs, but let me give them in a squeaker. Jets on the road against the Patriots. It's no surprise to anybody. I think Bill Belichick's name has been one that's been circulating for weeks now that he probably will not be returning next year as the head coach for the New England Patriots. But this pick is for my favorite person that lives on the West Coast, and that is Luis himself. Give me the Jets on the road to beat New England.
You want me to run wild over your misses? Just let me know.
Speak about misses, Bears and the Packers. This pick is for Reed's misses, and that's the Chicago Bears over the Packers. Give me them.
Chicago, Chicago.
The Philadelphia Eagles and the New York Giants. Reed, we were talking about the Eagles extensively on this episode, and I think they're going to be sputtering into the playoffs. Give me the Giants in a thrilling upset victory.
Thank you.
Cowboys and Commanders. Give me the Cowboys.
The fucking Commanders! Ah!
Seahawks on the road against the Cardinals. The Cardinals have shocked the world by beating not only the Cowboys, but also beating the Philadelphia Eagles recently. I'm going to have them win out. I'm going to have them win this last game at home against Seattle. San Francisco and the Rams. San Francisco sitting all their team, but it's not going to matter. The Rams are trash. Give me the Niners.
Thank you.
Chiefs and Chargers. Zoo called it correctly about being an upset in Arrowhead, and I think Patrick Mahomes is very, very upset about his team's performance this year, and I feel they're going to have to get this win to it's a get right game for them in LA. So give me the Chiefs.
Okay.
Broncos and Raiders. Give me the Raiders.
No.
And to end it all with the first pick of the whitest team you know, Josh Allen, give me the Buffalo Bills over the Miami Dolphins on the road. This $10 bet on a 16-pick parlay. Reed, the lines have been moving since we talked. I haven't pressed the big yellow button yet, but this $10 bet will win $550,000, $550,857.93.
My God.
You're welcome.
I'm down with it. Okay. Oh, we're going to win some money this week. I can feel it.
All the money.
All the monies. Well, thank you, Scott Ellia, for being here. Notice we did not bring up anything that could be, you know, potentially triggering for you. That could be saved for a different show. I'm not saying any names, but Ray Charles would say,
Georgia.
We don't want to talk about them right now. But you can catch them on the 323 Network. YouTube, go subscribe, like all the videos, watch all the videos. Even if you don't watch the whole thing, just watch it for a minute. Gets us a view no matter what.
Just turn it on in the background and put it on your computer and just turn it on. Just close the tab out.
That's right. Forget Club Shay Shay. Come to Club Riri. That's where you need us. So go. You can check Scott out on College Shame Day. We will have a new one out for you soon to get you ready for the national championship game. Scott, thank you for being here, buddy.
No, thank you, Reed. And I'm sure we'll be talking very soon about college football and the shambles that are going on right now.
That's right. In the meantime, folks, go subscribe again, 323 Network on YouTube. You can see our beautiful faces. You can see the fun videos that we played here today. It's the place that you want to be. Again, patreon.com/323Reed. All social media at 323Reed. That is at 323REID. In the meantime, folks, we will talk to you later. Stay safe.
Thank you.